Hi, welcome to How to Paint Easy Elegant Grapes. I'm Patricia Rollinson. Today I'm going to show you how to do easy grapes using a multi-part stencil. So we've got a base coat part, and then we've got the different layers, and all of it's done with crescent brushes and dry rubbing, and it's super, 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 super simple and really easy to do, and I think you're going to love it. I've also got decoupage and texture and image transfer. And so we've got a lot of techniques with this, as well as a really neat little overlay that we've got. So I think you're going to enjoy the lesson. Enjoy. Okay, we're going to take our roller, because we've got four panels, and we're going to take leach sand. And the reason I say we're going to take the roller because we have four panels is because I wouldn't probably get the roller dirty just for a little 8 or 9 inch square. But because I'm doing four things, I'm going to go ahead and just roll on my surface, and then it just goes real quick and gets it nice and even. And then we'll let that dry and we'll go on to the next step. Okay, when we get a mess on our nonstick craft mat, just give it a little mist with water and give it a little scrape. Okay, and then when you get it all scraped, it doesn't take the scraping. You could actually probably just wipe it, but the scraping just make sure it gets all the little stuff. You just wipe it up with a paper towel and you're clean and ready to go again. Okay, we're going to go and get our surface rebased. And you don't have to take it all the way out to the edge because we're going to do the edge dark. Just get some sloppy stuff on there. Do make sure you get it close enough, though, because we want to make sure that we don't have, okay, now we're going to slip slop with antique white. And I'm using this oval glaze, and this is the 1 inch, and this is indispensable. Everybody needs one of these in their tool chest, because it just does miraculous, awesome things. Okay, so I'm slip slopping the two colors, and I don't want to make mud. So I'm going to slip slap and try to leave irregular things so that it's interesting. Okay, and I think that's probably pretty good. Any big long things, you could go in and soften just so that they're not big long streaks. Okay, we're going to mix Texture Crackle. This is DecoArt's Texture Crackle, and this, what it does is it actually adds texture, and it will crack as you do it. And this is the tintable one, so this comes in kind of this weird white color. And the medium is thixotropic, which means that it will get smoother and creamier as you mix it. So it comes out kind of lumpy, but then it's like nice and cold creamy, and if you're mixing it around, it doesn't matter. It doesn't change the crackle. It's when it starts drying. So I'm going to get those nice and creamified. And then we want to add some paint to tint it, and we don't want to add more than, I think it's more than like 40%, something like that. Be careful, don't add too much. Okay, so I'm just going to add some bleach sand and add some antique white. Oops, whoa, hi. If you add too much color, then you break the crackling of the product. So the key is to add just enough to make it the color you want. It doesn't work so well for colors like red, because then they just get neutralized by the white color and it becomes pink. But the lighter colors work great. Okay, so get those. Now what we're going to do is we're going to pick up, and I've got my wider offset palette knife. We're going to pick up our crackle, and we're just going to skim coat here and there. Oops. And then make a funny texture. And you can just do it nice and flat. You can do it, you can break it up. Whatever makes you happy. Now remember, we're going to image transfer over the top of this, so this is not our final deal. Okay, and then you've got to make sure you let this dry. Okay, so we're going to do our frame. We're going to use a jumbo dauber so we don't get a bunch of paint gunked up in there. And we're going to use burnt sienna. And we're just going to go and give it one or two base coats. Oh, and my little piece didn't fall out there. That'll just pop out once I give it a little nudge. Yeah. There we go. Come on. I'll get it out in a minute. Anyway, so you don't want to scoop up a lot of paint. You really want this to be flat. And every now and again, give it a little squish and then re-stipple. And that way you don't pick up too much. Okay, and then once you get one side all done, hold that down so I'm not making too much noise, then what we want to do is give it a little bit of a higher color, and we'll go into burnt orange. And we'll just kind of bring that burnt orange up the middle. Don't want it too orangey, and I don't want it too brown, so I'm kind of doing a little compromise here. And we'll continue on the other sides, and we'll let it dry. Okay, we're going to do our faux finish on this, and thank goodness we do have many little sides to do, because this takes just a little bit of futzing, but it's going to be well worth it because it'll be nice and deep. And I've made a mess all over my handle. Hang on. Okay, so we're going to go into drying time extender, and then we're going to brush it, and we're not going to worry about it weeping down. You don't want to sop it, make it sopping wet, but we're not going to worry about it weeping down into the cracks because it'll be okay. Then I'll mix just a little bit of drying time extender with deep burgundy and traditional burnt umber, and I'll just put that over as a glaze real thin. And then we take our rake brush and we put it in rubbing alcohol, and then we make spatters happen. And if I get you in closer, oops, wrong direction. Get you in closer, you can see all of those little spatters. So we're going to do a couple layers of this. By the time you get all the way around and get back to the other one, then we should be dry and ready to get going again. So it shouldn't be too silly. Okay, and then we'll just keep rotating around. Okay, just to give you an idea of where we're going, this is level one, and I went ahead and set up a blow dryer station. I've got a little drink container that's made out of metal, like it clamps to my table, and I just set my blow dryer in there and let it just dry while I'm doing the other layers. So this is our first level, and then this is with just the one color, and there's a thing that has been popped out. There we go. Anyway, and so then just go ahead and finish all of them, get them dry, and then I'll show you what the next level is. All right, so our next coat, we're going to do basically the same ding dang thing. And you do need to make sure that you have enough of the medium in your in the brush with the top coat, with the top color, so the mix. Pick up a little medium, and that, if you don't have any, then it won't do the special effect. And now we're going to sneak a little bit more towards the brown. And so we'll do two sides at once. We've got a little conveyor system. This has only taken about maybe 10 minutes. Which, considering there are eight things, I was a little bit wary of that. Okay, so I'll get that all spattered. The blow dryer, of course, is helping tremendously. And don't forget to do thinner spatters for a different look completely. And when you get this all layered up, it's very, very, like, it's very subtle effect. Okay, next we're going to wash our brush out. The one that had the medium in it, and I'm going to side load with soft black, and we are going to float on the edge. And by using water this time, it'll dry a lot faster than the medium. Okay, and that gives it just a nice kind of framed look. Okay, and then we'll get out some lamp black and we'll thin, oops, rolling our palette knife into our black. Okay, we'll thin this with water and we'll tap on our palette. Stay away from anything you like. Okay, and then right at the edge, I'll give this some spatters just for a little bit more interest. Turn it around. We might need to go ahead and do just a little bit of the metal powders. So I'm going to pull out my metal powders and I'm going to combine it with clear glass stain, which is, they have this in a bigger jar now, which is great because I use this stuff pretty fast. Oops. And I'm making a mess. Okay, so I'll combine the gold powders, the brass powders. Let me get you on camera. Look at how shiny that gets. Like, this is how you get your gold paint. Okay, and then we'll take our palette knife, spatter that. So I thinned it after. And I don't want this to be really, like, gaudy. So I just do just a little bit for a touch of something going on. That, once it's dry, is our frame. Okay, we're going to use the Decoupage Photo Transfer Medium to transfer our image. We've got beautiful, beautiful images. So we print these backwards for you, and we're going to apply them onto the print. And we don't need it to go all the way to the edge. And I really like not to go, when I'm doing image transfer, I don't like my medium to be out here near the edge of my paper, because if the medium gets on top of the paper, then it won't come off, and so that's a bad thing. So you can see, if we get up close, the little cracks here and there. Okay, so I've got a good, interesting texture going on, and then the mediums, because this is actually a color image, anything that's color will transfer, so I'll end up with some self-shading, and I'll have this back detail and stuff like that. If it was just black and white, the paper, the white always comes off because printers don't print in white, which I thought was really an interesting difference, an interesting fact. Okay, so get that on there nice and thin. And actually, you know, I'm using completely the wrong brush. I'm sitting there trying to get all these things smoothed out and everything, and I'm realizing they make a brush just for this. This is a 4-inch applicator brush with a really short nap, and I can just get that on there in like a couple strokes. And it's smooth, so perfect. Now, because time is of the essence when we're doing things like this, we want to go ahead and apply some medium to the front of our paper as well. And then we flip it over. The one thing that we are going to want is straight. The rest of it doesn't matter to me. I don't care if it's what part of the image gets transferred where. Okay, we press it. And we look for just a little empty cap or something. And we start smoothing. We smooth out any bubbles and burp out any of the medium. Try not to wear a hole in your paper, so if it's catching on those bumps, then switch to your hand. Work from the inside out and radiate towards the edges so that the medium kind of burps out. Anything that's a big lump will be a big lump when you get done, so you do definitely want to make sure to get it all burped out. And then as it's drying, or as it's softening the paper, you'll find that you can get more medium and more medium kind of burped. So be aware of that and continue to work it until things start setting up a little bit. I'm using gentle pressure, but nice even. Don't want any bumpies. Okay, Okay, then we're going to let this dry for at least 8 hours or overnight. And in my case, I'm going to let it dry overnight because I always rush it and I always lose part of my image. And I don't want that to happen. And I want you to learn from my mistakes. No sense in both of us doing this wrong, right? Okay. Okay, I just was randomly just squishing stuff out and my container got some glue on the top and then I ran it through the middle of my board. I quickly wiped it off with a paper towel and I can still see it there, so I'm hoping that it's okay. Now the good news is, and I'm telling you this so that you can watch for what you're doing, the good news is that it happened right in the middle, so if I have paper that clings right there in the middle, I'll sand a little bit and then I will put my grape right over the top of it and you'll never know that it was there. But don't go on the side where it's got a rim right there because you don't want to have that medium seeping out. And if you do, wipe it away with your paper towel instead of with your pressing container. Okay, so we're going to take our paper. This has been drying overnight. And I've already got my table all messed up here. Okay, I've got a great big jug of water. It's just plain old water. And I'm going to spritz it pretty heavily. You could sponge it on, you could brush water on, whatever you want. This one has been sitting here for about five minutes or so. And that's the difference between the two of them. You can see more of the design elements. You can see the paper looks way more saturated. And what I'm going to do is peel off as much of this as I can. And see, I got quite a bit of it. It's the longer soaking that helps you peel it off in big old sheets instead of little pills. So get that as much as we can off. And then we're going to take a paper towel because your hands will get very tired of this if you don't get some help. And then gently, because you don't know how long your stuff has been drying or whatever, so you want to make sure that it's going to release without taking off the picture. And just go ahead and start scrubbing off the paper. So what's happening here is there's been a chemical bond between the chemical of the medium and the ink or the laser plastic that prints. Okay, so now what we're doing is we're peeling off the paper backing. Okay, so it put plastic sheets of, so the ink deposited its medium on the paper and melted it and adhered it. And we're just taking the paper off now. So it's almost like a transfer sheet. Okay, and then in the meantime, you've got your other frames. If you're doing more than one, you've got your other ones soaking so that they're going to be nice and softened up and ready to go. This comes off in about three layers is what I've found. Is you get this kind of the big stuff, then you get this kind of medium stuff, then you'll get really fine stuff, and then the final stuff, so that's four layers. The final stuff is really like almost like your skin when your hands are dry. And when it's nice and smooth, that's when you're done. And it doesn't take very, very long. It takes maybe about 5-10 minutes a piece. But given the amount of detail and awesomeness on there, like how long would that take you to paint? It's impossible. Okay, so just keep rolling off the stuff. And at some point, I move over to my trash can. And then I just do the little stuff into a trash can because it starts getting messy. Okay, as your surface dries, actually if you hit it with a blow dryer, you'll see that it will become kind of chalky. And like when I put my hand over this, I can feel little pills and you can see them coming off. And what you want as you get to the final stages is you want to have friction. So you don't want this sopping wet for the final stages. Sopping wet is great for the beginning, but not for the final. Somebody got some glue on top, I think. Okay, if I want to, I can go ahead and give it a little bit of a squirt if I'm not getting any friction. And that's, see, that's too much. I'm not getting any friction at all with that. Dry it off and then, yeah. And so what we're getting is we're getting some of this background image, we're getting the different layers of texture, we're getting the texture of the paper, and you've just got a layered, layered, layered texture look. All right, I'm going to be using this stencil over and over again, so I want to make sure I have it nice and sticky. So what I'm doing is I'm loading a paper towel in to tack it over and over, and I'm going to just apply a thin layer to the back edges of my stencil. I'm using the paper towel so I don't have to clean up. This stuff dries really, really tacky and sticky, and so I just want to chuck this little bit of paper towel. Don't do it thick. If you do it thick or have any thick areas, then it'll leave residue on your surface. So you want to make sure you flatten everything out nicely. Okay, and that's about how it should look, just nice and flat. When it dries clear, it'll be ready to use. As I'm experimenting with my leaf colors and things like that, I wanted to see what it would look like to bring some different values into my leaves and like have some background and dimension and stuff like that. So I'm just wiping out all my paint, and then I can create a little bit of a layered leaf look. And I'm just going right over my base coats, not worrying about any of that stuff. And that just really gives it a little bit more like awesome dimension. All right, I've marked my frame on my board. And now we're going to go ahead and base using the stencil. And then I'll just move from frame to frame because I've got four of them. The leaves will all be the same for them. And I've got a little hair here. Some of my hair, too, sticking to the stencil. Okay, so we'll take our dome brush and we'll take a light avocado. And we'll just go ahead and base coat. Stippling straight up and down. And I've got a technique to get rid of the texture that I'll show you in just a minute. Okay, I've got two coats on there. And now to get rid of the stipple marks, I'm just going to dry rub over the top. And that'll even everything out and not make it look stencily. Okay, we're going to put our details on now with a mask, or with the same leaf stencil, but we're using it as a mask. We're going to go into, celery green plus a little light avocado. And we're going to do the tips of the leaves. And we're just going to dry rub. And I'm using the crescent brushes because they do just such a great job. Okay, and the idea is not to have it be too chalky. Okay, now down over here, we're going to go behind our grapes. We want to not have so much highlight. But we want to bring it around the horn here. Okay, and we'll just continue. Start at the lightest area and then draw it in. Maybe we'll hit those stems just a little bit. Okay, now we'll go into just celery. And we won't bring that as far in. And I'm drying it off on my paper towel nice and strong. And notice that I'm going in little circles. Okay, now we're going to go into celery plus green tea. And we'll focus this just on the tips where things will be the brightest. We can lift our stencil up and take a little peek. Look pretty good. Okay, now I'm going to neutralize the paint in my brush with avocado, and that means I'll wipe it all out, and then I'll wipe it all out again. And that'll make it not be light. And really rub that out now that we've kind of loaded paint in there three times. Okay, and now we're going to go in our middle area and kind of create just that little bit of crease that would be up the middle of the leaf. And shade darkly behind and in the middle there. It's a nice way to float in the middle of something where you can just like draw the line in. Okay, next we'll go into evergreen, is that right? No, plantation pine. And now we'll go into black grain. And this one, you want to be a little bit more careful with this color because it can kind of take over. Okay, and then be careful. Got a little bit of a hole lifting right there. So you want to be careful not to work too much wet and wet. Okay, now let's peel that off and take a peek. That's awesome. That's just going to be perfect. Okay, if I wanted to have a little bit more leaf greenery and stuff, I could lay my leaf, and then I showed you that at the beginning, where I did it with just a mix of like burnt umber and stuff to create just a little bit of a background. And right now I'm not sure if I want that or not, so I'm just gonna wait until I see what the whole effect is on my piece. Okay, the very first thing we're gonna do for our grapes is we're going to, this is the red grapes. And for the purpose of the video, all of these steps are the same for the different colors of grapes on the recipe collection, so. But the technique is all the same, so I'm just going to video just the one. Okay, so in this case, we're doing the red grapes, and we're going to do black plum. And we're going to do two coats, plus we're going to do that scumble to make the texture go away. I got the tack it over and over on the back to prevent the stencil from sliding all over the place. Okay, now with the base coat done, I had to put three to cover over my leaves, and now I've got a little goober right there. The base coat done, I'm going to realign, I can get this, and I want to eliminate any kind of stencil-y look, so I'm going to go ahead and just load my brush with a scant amount of paint, and then I'm just going to swirl, and this is going to alleviate any stencil-y texture. It'll make it look much more like you just did a base coat, and how easy is it to base coat through a screen versus base coating in a line. Alright, so next we go on to step number two. The neat thing about the stencils is they're lined up so that you can just do each layer by itself. And I've got, just experimenting, I've got a set of grapes done. And if you can see, I don't know if you can see it really well, but this one I didn't eliminate the texture. I really like it better when I eliminate the texture, so that's important. But only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 areas of the original grapes show. Okay, so make sure that your texture in those quadrants is definitely minimized, because I think it'll look much prettier. And it's a little bit darker that way too, which I think I'll like as well for the additional depth. You're going to layer your next stencil over, and I don't know if you can see this very well, but there is a little etched outline on each set of grapes so that you can exactly place it with your original base coat. Okay, so I'll get that. And it's actually designed to be a little bit outside of the line, because if you ever had a stencil where you laid it over the top and it was inside the base coat, then it will make it look like it has this little like cast line or something. So it's a good, this is intentional, intentional overage. And I'll just line everybody up, make sure that I've got it overaged the way it's supposed to be. And there we go. Okay, so we're gonna get our deep burgundy and we're gonna use our crescent brush. And we're just gonna go ahead and fill in these grapes with deep burgundy. And we'll dry them. All right, we're gonna paint this just exactly like you would normally paint something. You're gonna highlight it and then you're gonna shade it. If you do the shading after the highlighting, then it creates more of a glaze situation and it's actually more appealing. I'm going to highlight using a crescent brush and I'm gonna use the little size. This one is 1/4 inch. I'm gonna use the little size for my highlight and then I'm gonna switch to a slightly bigger size, 3, I've rubbed the numbers right off. It must be 3/4 or 3/8, I'm not sure. Okay, so it's just roughly the next one up or two up from this one. Sorry. And then, so, I'm going to use the bigger one for the shading so that it kind of can go over my highlight just a little teeny bit, and that will kind of suck everybody together and make it look more uniform. The way you want to do your highlights is you want to choose your palette so that you have the next color lighter. So we're going to go into Country Red and dry rub that off. Okay, and we need to choose where our highlights are going to be. So I'm going to choose this upper left quadrant on my grapes. And you really want to rub the stuff off. You don't want to make it be really wet. Okay, and the first color is not going to show very much, but you're going to build it just as if you would with any other highlight process. The neat thing about this technique is anybody could do this. Absolutely anybody. You can get your grandkids involved, you know, you can do whatever kind of beginner class that you want, and it's just going to be approachable by just everybody. We'll let that dry for a minute and then we'll move into our next highlight. Okay, so that's dry. We're going to pick up with a dirty brush our Terra Coral. And now this we're going to bring out, whoops, dry it off more. If you got a lot of paint coming off, then that is not going to be pretty. We're going to move this in just a little bit from the edge. And you could almost go to the next smallest brush. So we're definitely going to be using things. I've got the medium-sized grapes. There's actually a set of these that is smaller, and then there's a couple sizes that are bigger. So this one is pretty small sized. I think these are 3-inch tall grapes. I'd love to do these around one of the bentwood boxes. I think that would be really cool. I am going to switch to a smaller one because the next thing that I'm going to want to do is going to be really small. Next highlight. Now set that brush aside. I'm actually working on step-by-step worksheets as well. Okay, so now we're going to do the next step. Make sure you're dry. I'm going to go into a little coral shell. And because I've switched to a clean brush, I want to wipe my brush off on a dirty spot on my paper towel to get kind of that married color. All right, so we'll come up here. Go get a little bit more married there. And I can pick up from my paper towel sometimes, depending on how juicy the paint was when I started. Okay, it's looking pretty good. You can take a little peek if you want to. Look how neat those look. They're like awesome already. Okay, and we can go into just a teeny bit of our, is it butterscotch? Yeah, butterscotch. And maybe up here, let me wipe that off just a little bit more. I'm gonna give it that little bit of kind of yellow. A little bit of orange, a little bit of yellow. Okay, we'll go into our bigger brush, and I'm going to go into the Country Red. And I'm going to kind of sweep Country Red across the middle. Over my highlights, just sweeping very gently. I'm going to red them up just a little bit. And then we're going to go into Soft Black. And we might need to step back just a little bit into Black Plum. And we'll sweep that across the base. Have you ever floated like this before, huh? It's pretty neat stuff. Okay, now into Soft Black. And then that's going to be just at the ever so darkest base. Do it a little bit crescent. Okay, let's take a look. Okay, I think we could shade just a teeny bit more on those. I'll drop it back down. And I'll drop that shadow way down, and I can be a little bit juicier. Okay. And I think we can go up one on the highlight. We'll add additional little highlights at the very end. Okay, see how that's a little bit brighter there? I like that. And loosen it. Okay. And there we go. That's our first layer of grapes. Okay, our next coat on step three is going to be Country Red. And I did two coats, and I'll let that dry. Okay, now we're going to highlight using the same technique as before, and basically the same color palette throughout. Okay, we're going to take our, Terra Coral. I'm going to mix it with just a touch of the Country Red. I want to make that into a family member. Okay, and I'll do this coat gets to be highlighted biggest, largest. Probably could have switched up to a bigger brush. I'm scrubbing all my paint off too quick. And since I can't really see that, I think I am going to switch up a brush. I've got my brushes in a plastic bag to keep them from drying completely out. Yeah, this will make much faster work. And then I'll repeat with that color. Make sure I'm dry. And I'll cover less area. Okay, now we'll switch to a slightly smaller brush, and maybe we'll mix. I don't know why I'm shying away from this color, and we'll mix a little bit of the coral shell in with the Terra Coral. And we'll get into that middle area, and see that little hole right there in the middle? That is called digging a hole. I'm going to hit this with a blow dryer to prevent that from happening. All right, bring that in. And then to get rid of that hole, I'm just going to stipple once or twice over the hole and then let it dry. It's really important that you graduate your highlight so it doesn't, so that you don't do light all the way out to the edge of the first highlight. You got to have a little bit of supporting. It's like gardening, where you have tall flowers in the back, otherwise you can't see the short flowers. So the first highlight is our tall flowers, and then the subsequent highlights are less and less, and there are shorter flowers. second. I think we could pop up one more, and let's mix a little bit of that butterscotch in with the coral shell. And we'll come back down here. Gives it just that little bit of yellow I kind of like. And we might even need to go into bleach sand for this. Seems like I'm not quite getting the brightness that I want. A little bit more. Sometimes when you first dip into a color, it neutralizes too much. Okay, let's take a peek. Okay, yeah, it's getting pretty awesome. Okay, I'll stuff these into my bag. Take that drying. Oops. Throw it on the floor. Stick out my tongue. All the funny things. Okay, so now we're going to go into Black Plum. And you know, actually, I wonder if I want to go ahead and give this just a teeny bit of the Country Red. Oh, I've got so much paint in that brush. Just to preserve the redness up the middle. And I'm just dusting that just ever so slightly. And now we'll go into Black Plum. Remember that our shading needs to be in a crescent moon shape to preserve the look of a grape. Super important. You can use the same construction doing a regular base coat without the stencil. You would just, you wouldn't be able to dry rub next to the edge because you would, of course, go out of the edge. But you could float instead if you're, if you like to float. You could just float your color instead of dry rubbing. Okay, go and bring the color up just a little bit. And, of course, into Soft Black. Okay, and so the soft black will go on there really kind of strong over there. Make sure you're doing the crescent thing. And you're doing tall flowers, if you know what I mean. Take a peek. Yeah, those are looking really nice. Okay, and then after we're done, we'll go into these different areas here with a little float to show that this one's on top of that one and all that kind of stuff. But we won't do that until the very end, and that way we know who is all on top of everybody else. Now, if you wanted really simple grapes, as I'm looking at this, you could almost be finished right now. And don't forget, if you needed an extra grape someplace, you could just set one of these grape cutouts. Whichever kind of size or shape that you wanted, and you could be like, okay, I think one more right there might do the trick, and then you could make your own pattern. So you don't have to use these as they're laid out. You can actually just use them as shapes. So we're going to go into the next one. Step four. I personally don't think that there's an easier, better way to paint grapes, especially what I like about this. I'll talk to you as a designer for a second. This configuration of grapes went through probably 10 iterations. It was a really difficult thing to do because notice that the grapes turn out at different angles. And so when I'm drawing grapes, generally speaking, they'll be balls and they'll be, they won't be very realistic looking because I don't know how to configure them. So with my brilliant co-designer, Dustin, we went ahead and figured out how grapes would actually lay on a vine, how the branches would come out, and how they'd support them. So these are as close to an authentic actual layout as we could get. So it's much easier to do these with a stencil than it is to try to sketch them and do them yourself. So I like this just for the realism that you get. And then I played around with doing just dustings of things with the leaves, where I mixed a little bit of brown in there, and you could go into the background here and you could create little ghost bunches of grapes if you wanted to create a deeper look as well. There's really a lot of things that you can do with this besides just base coat and shade. Okay, I'll get you all lined up here. And this one's going to be based with the same country red as well. It's really a lot of the same steps over and over again. Make sure that you are smooshing your brush off so that you don't get a lot of bleed under. The bleed under would be a bad thing. That's why we're using that tacket. Okay, so now we go into Terra Coral. You know, I think my Terra Coral is not very shaken up. Yeah, because I was getting some of the lifting and stuff like that, I think now that I've shaken my Terra Coral, notice that this pile of paint is nice and perky and kind of round, and this is kind of flat and oozy. That usually is a good indication. And I should get better coverage as well, so I want to be a little bit careful that I don't startle the highlights by suddenly having a much stronger version of Terra Coral. And yeah, that's covering a lot better, and it's not leaving that weird little mystery socket in the middle. We'll repeat a couple of times to strengthen that. Okay, we'll go into our coral shell. A little bit sticky in the attempt it anyway. Okay, just that little spot there in the middle. When you have to rub harder and you're on these final highlights, reload your brush because it will make a big difference. You'll get a much nicer highlight, especially with these little brushes. There's not much room to carry. Okay, and we'll get that little bit of butterscotch going. I think I'm going to leave these highlights for last. I'll just go ahead and get everything established first. Get out our shading brush. Same colors. Just repeat, right? Oops, and I didn't dust with the country red. I'll get that in a second. Okay, and then we'll go soft black. We're going to go through with the same technique for the top ones, and then we'll do our final detailing. Okay, now is where we get to put a little bit of our finishing touches on. So we're going to shade where things are on top of each other, and we can start with our black plum. I'm using a short bright brush. This is going to do a really good job of controlling my floats. I want really fine floats, and I'm going to mist my water bottle on a waxy palette. And so then what I can do with that is I can pick up just small amounts of water, okay, so that I can float with a really dry float, and that's actually a little bit too wet. You've got to have a misting bottle that works, that will bead up right. They're not quite off. You use the cheap, like, dollar store ones. I haven't had any luck with that. Okay, so let's go find out who's on top of whom. And just hop from grape to grape. Don't feel like you have to go all the way around the grape. Okay, just go find who's on top and then shade right next to that edge. Do not leave a gap like I just did. Okay, and that's going to help you make dominant grapes. Okay, so like this guy right here would be shadowed. This guy right here gets one. In some cases where this grape is behind this one and then behind this one, it might be okay to leave that highlight there. You can play around with that yourself. Okay, this guy definitely. Okay, and this is where we start really building that depth. This one I didn't quite get to my edge, and so I have that little halo we were talking about earlier. What I like about the stencils too is notice that like we have a big grape back here and a small grape here, so they're not all growing at the same rate. They're just different sizes according to like nature, if you will. So that means that we have, it's not uniform, hey, I'm a circle. And I don't want to make this into a career. So I'm not going to do like every single thing. And then I might go ahead and deepen some of these with soft black. Who do I want where? I think I'll do this guy. Pushes things to the top, pick up my water drop. Try to preserve the shape of your grapes. Don't let them get all kind of misshapen and stuff. Okay, so next we'll take a little round brush, okay, and we're going to take our highlights. And I'm going to dry brush, and so I'm going to flatten my brush into Terra Coral. And that this brush is a pro round, and it just keeps a nice flat. I can flick on my paper towel, and then what I want to do is kind of do a strong, and that's not going to work, so we're going to go into white plus a little Terra Coral. Okay, we want to get a nice shine. And actually, I don't like the Terra Coral, so we'll just do white. Okay, and we'll give it that lovely. And then with the Terra Coral down here on the bottom edge, apparently, so the grapes, they do their... The highlight comes in here, and then it travels through and comes out at the exact opposite location there. So, a little bit. And so that's just more muddy and more muted down at the bottom. Okay, and then we'll find more top grapes. Places where that shine can hit. And we'll do those a little bit more diffused that are behind. He's kind of buried in there, but we'll give him just a little bit. Okay, we're going to play a little bit with some of the cadmium orange and a little bit of the butterscotch mixed. And then every now and again, one of these is not going to be very ripe. And my problem is choosing which ones are not going to be, whoops, too much butterscotch. So just kind of give that a little bit of a glaze. Just to make those be not quite with the program yet. Okay, and that gives just a little bit more dimension. I think that bottom one. And they could be different variations of not quite ripe. I think we can go ahead and give this little back grapes just a little bit of something going on because they're kind of lonely back there. I think that helps. Okay, and then we could take a little teeny bit of our purple, our dioxazine purple. And we can go into some of our shadow areas and just kind of increase coloration. Okay, and then that gives us just a little bit more popping up. Okay, I'm going to add a little drop shading to my grapes. So what I'm going to do, I've already done one coat, I'm going to do all of this side. All of the lower right side. So I'm just going to come right along next to my grape and just shade, just like I was doing drop shading on a letter. Okay, and that's just going to give that grape like it's sitting up over that background just a little bit. I'll come over here and we'll do the same side of the leaf. And same thing over here, same thing up here on our stems. Yeah, and I think maybe we could go into a little bit of soft black even, suck up a water drop, and then just cinch that in just a teeny bit. Okay, gotta get that dry. Okay, come in just a little soft black. Just where things really would be deeply darkly. Okay. Yeah, I think that gives it some nice dimension. Okay, I'm going to do my line work on my veins, which is a really easy thing to mess up, so pay attention to this part. I'm going to show you what I do. I've got a 3-in-1 brush basin. Okay, and what I love about this, okay, it has a big enough cavity here for me to either rest foam brushes or to squeeze out sponges and stuff. It has a third little shallow well here where I could put my brush cleaner. This kind of plastic doesn't react to my brush cleaner, so that's perfect. Or I could put Easy Float and some water, whatever you wanted to back here, okay? This can be, you know, whichever way you want. This is also big enough to put your hand in as well. It's a little bit more awkward. This is better. I tend to use this for my dirty water, and I tend to load my water from the front. Okay, so I love the fact that there's all these different variations. When this was first introduced, I thought this is the silliest thing. I don't need a new brush basin. When I switched, I love. It's just absolutely remarkably different. This handle really makes a difference for me. When I'm writing patterns and doing things like that, and they have little doodads at the bottom to rub against, to scrape your paint out as well. But this little guy, it has these little concave little holders here, and your brushes can rest there and they won't roll away on you. Okay, and what I love about this, in this particular case, I'm going to be doing some lining. So I pre-soak my brush. A soaked paintbrush will absorb way more paint and make way prettier floats than a non-soaked paintbrush. Okay, so it's a really killer difference between like a pro technique and not. So if I'm gonna be floating, I can pre-soak my brush and I can rest it right there where it's not gonna roll away and it's not gonna make a big old mess. Okay, and then case in point, let me show you how, or the difference. Let's go, we're gonna grab a piece of paper. Okay, so this is just a regular old piece of paper. And I'm gonna get a regular flat brush. I'll get a curved flat, because that's got long bristles and you can see it easily. It's a dry brush, so I'm going to just rinse it in my water basin and watch what happens when we float. So I'm gonna load water. And let's do the red. Okay, so I'll blend, blend, blend. Okay, so now when you first start out, dry brush, loaded with water, loaded with paint. Okay, so you're gonna get along, and it's not bad, but notice it's starting to get scratchy. Okay, and this is actually doing a really good job. Carries just a good amount of water. Okay. You'll notice that my float, and I gotta keep going because that's the exercise. Yeah, I'm not even carrying anything over here on this far edge. I still have a lot of paint though. So what I'll do is I'll come back over here. I'll pick up water. Now what's gonna be happening now is I'm going to be, what's happening right now is my brush has been soaking up the water that it has had in it, and then I soaked up some more water. Okay, and what you'll see is the quality. Oops, I didn't soak up quite enough. I always love for presentation things when things don't quite go the way I want them to. Okay, so you'll see that the quality of your float, and you know what, this isn't going my way at all. I'm just not soaking up enough water for my brush. That's funny. Okay, I'll come back over here. Okay, and now you'll see that the quality of your float is tremendously better than it was over here. And the reason for that is because you've got, your brush is saturated with water and it just makes really beautiful floats. Okay, and I'm just starting to kind of get a little bit scraggly, but notice that it really can keep going and going, and now I just don't even have hardly anything. But this also, the idea of these water drops will save you a lot of time floating. Because you don't have to go back into your water basin and go pre-wet everything again. So you get a much more transitioned float versus this is much scragglier. Anyway, so soaking your brush really does make a difference, even if I don't know how to do a good demo. Okay, so my brush has been soaking, and I will go, we always want to use thinned paint when you're doing that. So I've got my paint nice and thinned over here. Dance my brush, and when you are filling a liner brush, you always want to fill all the way up to the ferrule. You don't want to do that when you are using a flat brush or something like that. Okay, so now what we want to do is we want to bring our vein out, and we want to press a little bit heavier and bring it out that way, and then we'll branch that out just a little bit. And then just standing on our tippy toes, we can bring out additional little veins. Kind of have them do a little bit of a dance, be a little bit, not dance like really moving, but dance like not stick straight. Okay, and then if you needed to, you could highlight those with a little bit of bleach sand. Okay, and I'll come over here. Some these are fading just a little bit, so my contrast isn't as good as it could be. Try not to make them perfectly straight. And then lift up onto the toe. The remarkable thing about these Raphael brushes is they will go up to a microscopic little point. And you can't get that variation very easily with regular
liner brushes. You need something that has a good body. And these brushes will last you for 30 years. It's very, very well known for them to last for a really long time. And one load of water and paint will last you for a very long time as well.
Okay, so now I'll go in, and let's go into, let's see, a little bit of, what do I got here? I think I want, well, the plantation pine will probably be fine.
So what we'll do is we'll come in next to our vein and just give that just a little bit of drop shading to give it some contrast.
Yeah, that helps. Okay, I'm basing my underneath the overlay with just a ratty brush and just kind of getting some color back there. Okay, and it's soft black, black green, and burnt umber. And I'm just kind of mushing the colors in there together. I'm trying to put a little bit more of the black green in my corners where the leaves are cut out. A little bit of brown up the middle for some rusticness. Oops, that's the wrong color. Okay, and then to make sure that I have, got a second, to make sure that I've got the whole leaf area cut out, I've traced my little layout right there. Get that smoots off of there. And then I'll just base in to make sure that my whole leaf gets based. Okay, so I've got that based and basically dry. I'm going to use burnt umber and a big old brush. And I'm going to glaze my edges. It's going to make everything kind of frame and sink in just a little bit. I love the image transfer. I love the texture. I love all of this. This is just so cool. I know it's harder to see in video, but boy, in person, it's really striking. Okay, and that just gives us a little bit of anchoring. And I think what I'm going to do is go ahead and repeat that step as soon as I dry it. Okay, so we'll go ahead and we'll load. I think I don't want it too. Okay, I'm going to do a little mix here. I've got my soft black and burnt umber. And then I'm just going to go ahead and round out my corners, and that'll antique it just a little bit more. Round in our frame. Is that better? I like that. Just cross those corners. Okay, yeah. And see how it's making that yellow in the middle area just really come out. And I wonder about creating a little bit more depth behind our leaf and our grapes. Okay. Yeah, I like it. Okay, I'm still not happy with my antiquing, so I'm going to go into soft black, burnt umber, just to soften it down just a teeny bit, and I'm going to go more aggressively. Yeah, like that better. Got to kind of just stab that color over there and say, come on, walk it out. We'll get into a big old blending mop. Settle everybody in just a little bit better. Okay, that looks much more like it. Okay.
I'm going to use my Triple Threat Ghost Rider and the white lead, and I'm going to use my see-through ruler. I just want to have a little taped line moment going on here for some leaf or some metal powders. Oops. And don't forget. I love this little ruler because it has a zero centering thing in the middle, and it goes from one direction that way and one direction that way. Actually, that's not true. Both directions go the same way that way. But you can count up, and you can count from side to side, and it's all gridded. And it's flexible, so you can do glass and things like that as well. And they last forever. I use them with quilting and all kinds of things. So okay, I'm going to add a little metallic powder base or banding on here. I'm going to use an ink sweeper to apply it, and I'm going to use clear glass stain. I had a little experiment happen one day. I got called to the phone. I had some varnish and some glass stain on my palette. The varnish dried really cloudy, really, really, really cloudy, like you almost couldn't see through it, which was astounding to me. The glass stain dried as crystal clear as it is here. So when I'm doing my powders and things like that, I want the clearest, shiniest look. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take our powders. I've got brass here, and you can mix the powder, so you can get your own custom blend. Okay, you can mix them with paints, you can put them in clay, you can mix them together, you can do all kinds of stuff. So what I want to do is just really kind of create a little subtle look here. So I'm just going to kind of brush it just a little bit. I don't want a base coat kind of thing. So it's almost just like a dry brushing kind of glaze of that, just to add a little bit of chazelle, but not too much. Okay, and so we'll get a nice, nice band of it. Let me get my tape off so you can see it. Okay, and so that just adds just subtle, 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 and then I'll just plunk this in the back of my brush basin. See what we have there. Yeah, that just gives it that kind of finished elegance. I like it.